Mission El Sol, we are so glad that you have joined us for worship today. If you are worshiping with us online, I encourage you to let us know that you're here by signing in on the virtual friendship pad or on Facebook so that we might all greet each other following worship today. If you're a first-time visitor here, I encourage you to make your way to the welcome table after worship. You can find a handmade candle made by members of the church to guide you in your devotion and learn more about the church community and how you can get involved here. For kids, I hope you picked up an activity page on your way in, your way out, or after Sunday school. You can pick up a prize bag for completing the worship outline or the activity pages. But during church, we'll have a time for our young and young at heart to come sit on these front steps. We'll have a children's sermon together, and then all the kids will be excused to go to Sunday school, or room 108, and parents can pick them up there after church is over. I think that's what we need to know in order for us to start worship today, so I invite us to be called to worship.
Good morning. Please rise in heart and mind and join me in our responsive call to worship from the hymn, The Play of the Godhead. God the Creator and Christ the True Son. In spangles of mystery, the great three in one. Men, women, and children, and all living things, now join to sing. includes mercy, grace, and forgiveness. At the center of our story are the words, "My grace is sufficient for you. In Jesus Christ we are forgiven."
Thanks be to God.
Let us rise and sing our praise.
So that they don't have to try and remember. It's hard to keep keep track of everybody, especially when we're coming in late. Or early. I know who you all are. Tell our ushers out. It would be great if you could wear your name tags. And also for each other, as we're greeting each other during worship, to be able to know who we all are. Also, our hospitality team is still in need of folks to sign up for to host hospitality or the coffee hour after church. It's not hard. It's pretty easy. They've like taken off all the really hard parts and are doing that themselves. So if you'd like to participate or find a friend that would like to participate with you so you could do it together, that would be great. Or make some new friends and do that. They would appreciate it. And I know we all would when we get to have our snacks together. I think that's all of our upcoming announcements for the next week or so. I encourage you to see the soundings and the Saturday email for more things about the life and ministry of the church. But now I'd like to invite our young and young at heart to come for our children's message. You guys are going to want to be really close for this one because we're going to do an experiment. So come up close. Okay, I'll come over this way. You come this way. Come on, squeeze in. Squeeze down. Good job. So today in our scripture passage, we're talking about the story of Noah's Ark. Have you guys heard about the story of Noah and his Ark? You've heard the story of Noah's Ark? And Noah, he is asked by God to do something really big, right? He's asked by God to build a giant boat in the desert. Have you guys seen anybody building boats recently in the desert? No. I haven't seen anyone building boats, but it'd be like that. You see someone building a boat? You saw a boat in the desert? You saw the cartoon of this story? Yeah, I mean, there's lots of cute cartoons. He builds this giant boat, and he puts two animals of every kind on the boat, right? Well, now sometimes we forget about a big part of that story is about the promise that God makes. And God says that sometimes people weren't always doing all the right things. Have you guys ever done anything that you weren't supposed to? Have you ever made a mistake? I've made a mistake. I bet all these people have made a mistake. Right? We've all done things that we weren't supposed to do, and God says that that's not how we're supposed to live. But I want to show this to you. So this is why you guys are going to get close. Jeez, come closer. Come right. Come sit down here. You don't have to sit in this front row. You can scoot down to the second row. Come right down here. Good job. Come closer. Or not. Okay. So sometimes when we do things that we're not supposed to, like when we hurt someone's feelings, have you guys ever hurt someone's feelings before? I've done that. What do you think is going to happen? Come over here, Jason. Come here. You think the color's going to come out? Sort of coming out, right? Because it doesn't last. It hurts everybody's feelings, and it's not real love, right? When we hurt other people's feelings. Or when we break a promise, have you guys ever said that you would do something and then you didn't do it? Yeah, I've done that too. What happens? It just fades away because it's not true love, right? But when God loves, what do you think will happen when we put God's love in there? Do you think it's going to fade away? Yes? Let's see. To shake it really hard. God's love doesn't fade away. It's still there. Because it doesn't matter what happens. That's what happens in our story, because in this passage it talks about how God is really upset, and that's why he had Noah build a boat. He told Noah to build a boat because everybody was so upset and hurting each other and being so mean that God wanted to just say, you know what, I'm going to start over with loving everybody in a new way. then, you know what, we all have to be loved anyway. We have to be loved just the way we are. And we have to practice loving. And so God says, my love will last. And he makes that big rainbow. Have you guys ever seen a rainbow in the sky? It's supposed to remind us that God's love lasts forever. And also to remind us that God wants us to love each other. Can we say a prayer together? Let's pray.
Dear God,
thank you for loving us.
Help us to love each other.
The scripture reading this morning is from Genesis chapter 7, reading from the first verse. The Lord then said to Noah, "Go into the ark, you and your whole family, because I have found you righteous in this generation. Take with you 7 pairs of every kind of clean animal, a male and its mate, and 1 pair of every kind of unclean animal, a male and its mate. And also 7 pairs of every kind of bird, male and female, to keep their various kinds alive throughout the earth. 7 days from now, I will send rain on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, and I will wipe from the face of the earth every living creature I have made." And Noah did all that the Lord commanded him. Noah was 600 years old when the flood waters came to the earth. And Noah and his sons and his wife and his sons' wives entered the ark to escape the waters of the flood. Pairs of clean and unclean animals, of birds and of all creatures that moved along the ground, male and female, came to Noah and entered the ark. As God had commanded Noah, and after 7 days, the flood waters came on the earth. In the 600th year of Noah's life, on the 17th day of the second month, on that day, all the springs of the great deep burst forth, and the floodgates of the heavens were opened, and rain fell on the earth 40 days and 40 nights. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. O Lord, guide us this day. Use the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts so that we might hear your word for us each. In your name we pray. Amen. So this is our second week in our series of trying to understand what God is trying to say, or at least what we think God is trying to say to us. As we hear God speak through these faithful stories in the Bible, and today we hear from Noah, one of the most well-known stories in the Bible of God speaking, because he turned his favorite story into one where God rescues animals 2 by 2 in a giant boat, which seems impossible and magical. In the end, there's a beautiful rainbow after the storm. That's not exactly what happens in the story, though, is it? The story begins the previous chapter from this one, where God looks from the heavens and realizes how broken our world is. It could not be blamed on one person or one event in history or a specific place or a specific time. Instead, all life and all relationships seem to be a little bit broken. All the relationships between God and us, and also the relationships between each other. God God saw corruption and judgment and hate and violence. And God thought that they had created a world with love. It was supposed to be good, but it didn't seem very good. Unfortunately, you can see a lot of that today. We see how we want to take what we want for ourselves. We judge each other without hearing the other side of the story. We take advantage of one another. We care more about ourselves than another person. And I don't know about you, but I don't like to see that. I can't imagine what God sees when he sees us do that to each other. And God decided that it really wasn't anything he could do to fix it. And so he feels discouraged and decides he's just going to wipe out the whole world. I know, I'm turning the Noah's Ark story into this very sad story. I'm sorry. Not just humans either. He decided he's going to wipe out everything. All the animals, all the plants, all the human beings, all the relationships with everything God created was going to start over. But somehow, between the time that God asked Noah to start building this ark, which could have been, 100 years, until the time he decided to send the floodwaters, God changes his mind. He sees Noah, and he realizes that even though we all have a little bad or hard in us, there's also a little bit of Noah in us too. Someone who is faithful, someone who's kind, someone who's willing to do something for somebody else, and somebody who's willing to do something that seems a little crazy when God asks him to do it. So God asks Noah to build a boat big enough for two of every animal and all the plants to start over once again after this flood is over. Noah builds a boat in the desert. Can you imagine what that was like? What all of the neighbors are saying to Noah when he decides to build a giant boat in the middle of the desert? What would your neighbors say to you if you decided to build a boat, if you decided to buy some property out of the middle of the desert where there's nothing out there, and you start collecting all this wood and these pieces of metal, and you start building a boat that's so big that everybody in town could fit in? I know what they would say. Are you crazy? You know we live in the desert, right? It doesn't even rain here. Why are you spending all of your time building a boat? But Noah kept building without any forecast of rain, because God said so. And we've all asked ourselves, would we build that boat in the desert? If we heard God saying, go and build a boat, would we say, that can't be God? But then I think about all the other crazy things people do. We build churches, just hoping that more people are going to come. We change jobs, knowing that the job we have is just fine, but the other one is something that we really want to do. We get married. I've never heard a logical answer for why anyone gets married. We stand up for injustices, even though they're not going to benefit us. In fact, they might even hurt us more than help us. But God says in that still small voice, go, do this. And we're convinced to do it anyway, even though it seems like the most illogical thing to do. And maybe if you're like me, you aren't sure if you have heard that voice of God in your life. That one that comes from on high that says, build the boat in the desert, take that job, marry that person, do that thing. But instead, it is that insistence, that urgence that says, you must go. In fact, if you don't do it, you won't stop thinking about this thing until you finally say yes. All you can do is think and act and do this one thing, and that, too, is God saying, build that boat. Sometimes it's about big things, like boats in the desert, or taking that job, or moving that place to that new place. But most of the time, it's small things that God asks us to do. Saying yes, or saying no, making that phone call, taking that extra stop, calling the doctor, inviting that friend over. One thing that small falls into another thing that falls into another thing. And that's what God is asking us to do. say yes to what God asks us, to follow God's lead, to trust that even when it doesn't make sense to make that call, that we do it anyway. To trust that even when things don't make sense, like it feels like it's really bad timing, that it isn't totally clear, that this still is the right time because of that urging that comes from God. And I know that it's right, because like Noah, every time you do those things, you finally feel at peace, even if you're building a boat in the desert. See, Noah heard God and followed. He obeyed him. And it's a good thing, because the floodwaters did eventually come, and Noah had put all of those animals into this boat and gathered two of every animal, all while his neighbors were watching, wondering why he was doing so. And then the challenge comes with this text. The challenge comes with this kind of request, the realization that God actually was angry with humanity, so angry that he wanted to kill every living thing and every person except Noah and his family. Can you imagine what it was like when Noah finally had the floodwaters come? And the neighbors told him he was crazy last week, but now they're saying, hey, do you have a little bit of extra space to fit me and my family in your boat? And slowly, as the waters rose, to realize that everything that you knew and loved was gone. All because you're faithful to God. Everything has changed suddenly, and it's not the way it used to be. Sometimes following God means standing up for what God wants, even when it's hard, even when the world tells you you're wrong. I think about all the people who stood up for God and God's call to love the world, even when the world said no. People like Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who are reading on our Wednesday morning book study, who stood up against Hitler during World War II, said, we must be ready to allow ourselves to be interrupted by God at any one moment. Or Martin Luther King Jr., who we celebrate tomorrow, said, use me, God. Show me how to take who I am, who I want to be, and what I can do, and use it for the purpose greater than who I am. Or even someone like Jane Goodall, who reminds us that the world, through her conservation, that you cannot get through a single day without impacting the people around you and the world around you. It takes a lot. They've all did hard things, and God asks us to do hard things too. But I don't know if I could always do it. I don't know if I can leave humanity behind. I don't know if I could be a Noah in the story. I mean, Noah wasn't even sure. In the next chapter, if you read along, he was caught sleeping by his own son. I think sleeping means something else, but he had drank a little bit too much. And we realized that Noah wasn't perfect. He didn't have it all together. He wasn't the person who just lived the perfect life, and that's why God asked him to do this. He just was a person, just like you and I, living our days, trying to hear God speak to us, and trying our best to follow, even when God says something crazy. Maybe you said, like Noah and I, am I good enough to be the one God chose to save the world? Am I even listening well enough to know if God is asking me to save the world by building a giant boat right here in Tempe? Here's the thing about this moment in time, about every moment in time, but really it's all about relationship. Because God sometimes asks us to do ordinary, normal things like love the people we love and take care of each other and go to work. God also asks us to do some unexpected and crazy things. But it isn't likely that God is going to ask you to build a boat in the desert if you aren't already talking to God. If you aren't already realizing that God gets frustrated and angry and wants things to be different and wants you to be better as much as God loves you just the way you are. By the end of the story, God stops the rain and announces to Noah that he didn't want to lose what he already had, that those broken relationships were still relationships that really mattered to him. And even though we made a lot of mistakes and things don't go as he expected, the relationship between you and God mattered more than anything else. time it rains, that God will keep working with us. He will keep helping us to be better and a better person. And I wonder if that promise that God made to Noah and to us is one of the ways God is still speaking to us today. That God is saying, every time you see that rainbow in the sky, that God did not give up on us. But also that we aren't supposed to give up on us either. We too need to be better at taking care of the world. God wants the world to change. God wants to speak to us every time there's a rainbow in the sky that says, I did not give up on the world. I have not given up on you, and you should not give up either. Sometimes I feel like it would be easy to give up on the world, to hide back in our little Mission Del Sol world and pretend like the things that are happening around the world, the wars, the hate, the violence, don't really exist. Maybe you even feel like I do, like can't really do anything about it, so why even pay attention? It'd be easy to drive on the streets and see a homeless person and say, they just need to help themselves. Or to ignore the violence and judgment that comes from one another, even the people we like. It would be easy to just think about ourselves and not care about the actions in our world or the world we live in, particularly the plants and the animals that God created from the very beginning too. But what if that rainbow in the sky was God saying to you, it's time to build a boat? Not a boat because the world's going to flood and this is our salvation. But what if it was a beautiful reminder of how we're supposed to take care of the earth? How we're supposed to pick up trash and care for the animals? That we're supposed to recognize our part in the brokenness and do something about it? What if it's about standing up for what's right, even when it means going against everything else that you know? What if it means don't leave people behind, but take them with you? Be faithful, be kind, be loving, love each other. Be who God created you to be, because that's what's most important. Because I promise, no matter what you do or don't do, God promises he's going to be with you through it. That is not going to change. But what could change is the opportunity of how we live in the world together, what it means to love each other in this world. And that, I think, is what God wants more than anything from all of us every time we see that rainbow. Amen. And with all those who faithfully come before us, I invite you to stand and profess our faith, saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. friends, as we go to God in prayer, we remember all of those promises that that God has given us. Let us go to these prayers. Jesus, we come to you in search of a beauty that's found in a promise that only you create. We come to restore our minds and our hearts in a world full of distraction. We come to seek your will and to do it. We have seen the signs in the morning sunrise and the smell of a good cup of coffee and a hug from a friend in a new year with new adventures and with rainbows, even the ones we saw this week in the rainstorms. This world pulls us apart and makes us focus on ourselves at the expense of community that you call us to care for. And we come to this place to remember that we are the people you called us to be. We're the ones that hear your still small voice to seek your peace, to find you in our lives. And we realize that as we lift up our prayers to you, you are the one who always hears us, who hears our joys and our sorrows, our supplications of our hearts. And we lift up our prayers to you, those spoken aloud and said in silence. Lord, in your mercy.
William's family.
Lord, in your mercy. 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 Lord, we lift up to you those who are grieving people they love, prayers that are in need, those who are needing healing care, those who are caregivers, those who've lost their way, those who are losing the battle between themselves and others, those who are unsure of where the rainbows are, those who've forgotten your promises. Holy Spirit, we know that after the rain, there is always a rainbow. From the rubble, there's always beauty. From the pain, there's healing. Out of the struggle, there's hope. Words can be spoken truth to power. And the beauty of your grace is that you call us to live differently, to treat others with respect, to love before hate, to speak truth, not lies, to live with faith and belief that you are our God and we are your beloved people. Live with faith and belief that you will help our world, that in the brokenness there is peace, to see the beauty of the rainbow that you created and the relationships that we have and the care for one another and the support of our neighbors and our friends, or lift up places that are in need of your great love and your care. We ask that you show us the ways to build those boats in the desert, to stand up for what you want, and to find our home wherever you are, just as we found comfort in the words you taught us, as we pray to the one we know as father and mother, as friend, as rainbow giver. We pray saying, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Too often we reflect on what Jesus saved us from, but the more important question is what are we saved for? Jesus has plans to use you to spread the gospel message. Sometimes Jesus uses your talents, sometimes your time, or other times your money. Join me in giving through the online giving webpage found in the link or QR code or in the offering. places and events that need our time, talents, and money. Guide us as we use these gifts for your glory and purposes in the church, community, and beyond. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Remember, no matter what has happened in the world or what's happening to you, God has not given up on the world yet. And God has not given up on you either. We are invited to be a part of that not giving up too. To go out into the world, to be kind and loving and gracious. To let the brokenness fall away and to see only rainbows around us. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ go with you. May the love of God the Father surround you. And communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always.